afternoon. I'm Marty Blank. I'm the president of the Institute for Educational Leadership. And I cannot tell you how honored I am to be here today at the first annual Sam Halperin Lecture in Public Service Award. Sam was the second president of IAL, starting in 1974 all the way through to 1981. And, you know, the hallmark of Sam's work at IAL, and I think of his whole career, was an effort to be both a partisan around the beliefs he had and the political ideology he supported, but bipartisan in his efforts to move change. Sam, most people remember Sam from the educational staff seminars. People would travel to all around the country to see what the world looked like on the ground. Not from the perspective of political parties or ideological perspectives, but from the point of view of people in real communities trying to help young people succeed.
AYPF's mission has stayed true to Sam's vision all of these years, and we continue to focus on vulnerable, at-risk youth and to realize that many of the challenges that were identified in the Forgotten Half in 1993, unfortunately, are still with us today, while other demographic, cultural, and economic challenges have been added to that list. So when we started thinking about who might give the first lecture for the Samuel Halperin Lecture, our list was actually really long, but it quickly shrank to one name, almost instantaneously, and that was Hilary Pennington. Hilary knew Sam very well. Their paths crossed many times as they worked on education, youth development, and workforce development, legislation and policy, and school-to-work policy, I should add, for those of you who remember, in the 80s, 90s, and 2000s. They were of like minds in trying to find policy levers to support at-risk youth and young adults.
But the amazing thing is to be able to be part of honoring Sam. And what would delight him more than new generation people who are in the Education Fellowship Program at IEL, rising talent for the challenges ahead, coming together with his partners in this work over such a long period of time. So I see myself as just a vehicle sort of to get us started for what I hope will be interaction with each other informally and in this session. And I want to thank Betsy, my dear friend. Sam was so proud of what you have done as a leader for AYPF and the spirit of leadership, the generosity of leadership and collaboration that you model that is too sorely needed in our world, especially our policy world. So thank you for this and for helping me think about how best to contribute. And as Betsy and Marty said, that report was a seminal report. It was led by a very, very distinguished commission. Dan Ankelovich, who turns 90 this year, was on that commission. William Julius Wilson was on that commission. A young lawyer and wife in Little Rock, Arkansas, named Hillary Clinton, was on that commission. And it was remarkable because it really did influence national policy and it changed the way in which we think about young people. So, where are we? I'm going to start out by just, I want to go back and just read you the first paragraph from the introduction to it because Sam probably wrote it and it's just beautiful, beautiful language and it's a way of bringing into this room the young people that we are still here to serve better than we do now. So he said, "Who are the Forgotten Half? In non-statistical terms, they are the young people who build our homes, drive our buses, repair our automobiles, fix our televisions, maintain and serve our offices, schools, and hospitals, and keep the production lines of our mills and factories moving. To a great extent, they determine how well the American family, economy, and democracy function. They are also the thousands of young men and women who aspire to work productively, but never quite make it to that kind of employment. For these members of the Forgotten Half, their lives as adults start in the economic limbo of unemployment, part-time jobs, and poverty wages. Many of them never break free." So that's not that different than the challenges that young people face today, all these years later. And we have a lot of work left to do. We've made enormous progress, and I want to start off by just acknowledging that because many of the people and organizations that have accounted for that progress are here in this room. Many more young people today are going to college than went to college then. In fact, the Forgotten Half Revisited talks a lot about the challenges of improving college success for the young people who now attend college. Institutions and partnerships have grown up that didn't exist there, including the rapid, incredible growth of community colleges and the role that they play in young people's transitions to adulthood. A number of kinds of industry partnerships, like the National Skills Workforce Fund, and many, many more ways in which the multiple systems that serve young people weave together. And I think most remarkably of all, an enormous amount of innovation in program delivery. If you think across remarkable kinds of organizations that are proving what works every day. So think about City Year, which Betsy mentioned, Youth Build, Europe, Talent Development High Schools, Gateways to College, and countless others who are proving every day that it is possible to make a difference, that it's possible to scale that impact, and it's possible to change public policy. But sadly, these programs do not function at the scale to which they should. They're not funded in the ways that they should be funded. They still turn away many, many young people who seek their services. And we haven't figured out how to dignify and finance that kind of work, even when we know and have been able to demonstrate what works. There has been also enormous innovation and progress in something we didn't know a lot about when The Forgotten Half was written. And that's all the learning that has been done about how learning and human development actually happen. How the brain develops, learning sciences, all the things that are fueling enormous innovation in personalized learning and perhaps technologies or data analytics that will help us do much, much better at customizing learning to the needs of young people in many parts of their lives, and that's an enormously powerful thing. But taken together, all of these kinds of innovations, all this progress, and so many that I didn't name and mention, don't add up to enough. And in fact, if you look at where we are today, we and young people have in fact lost ground. And I'm going to just share with you some of the statistics comparing 1980 and today because they're stark. Median earnings have declined. The unemployment rates for young people in that age group have declined. The numbers of young people who are living with their parents, about 20% of young people in this age group lived with their parents in 1980, over 30% do today. The numbers who live in poverty have grown from 14% to almost 20%. The numbers who have never married, who are delaying family formation, have grown from 40% to 62% have never married. The achievement gap between high-income and low-income students is bigger today than it was when the baby boom generation was in high school back in those decades. And even though bachelor's degrees have increased, the numbers of young people with a bachelor's degree in that age group has gone from about 16% to 22%. Many, many staggering barriers and obstacles face these young people as they move forward in a very complex and different world. A final gap, just to sort of call out, that interrelates with so many of the other ones, is the gap in assets that attach to young people at that age. 25 years ago, there was about a 10-to-1 gap in the assets held between people 65 and older and young people below the age of 35. And today, it is 47 times greater, the gap. And that's due to college debt, to lower employment, to stagnant wages or declining wages, to the decreases in housing value in proportion to the size of mortgages that young people have. So you take all of these kinds of trends together and you have to be sobered at where we start from despite the enormous progress that we've made. What is very much documented now, which is the growth in inequality, in income inequality, in asset inequality, and that is really happening where, you know, the top of the income spectrum is pulling away not only from the bottom but from all of the rest. And that distribution is not randomly distributed. The people who concentrate at the bottom are disproportionately associated with their race, with their gender, and that is a huge issue for the country and for young people as we go forward. Third, I think, is the effect of residential segregation and the kind of crazy way that we fund our public school system still to this day. Many public schools are more segregated racially today than they were when the Brown decision was handed down. And geographic proximity, zip code, as one often hears, has a disproportionate impact on young people's life chances, where they're born, what place they're born into. And we know that in all kinds of ways, proximity structures people's interpersonal relationships and interpersonal experiences. So that's a third trend that is that I think is challenging. Fourth, the institutions that we have trusted to disrupt inequality, particularly higher education, in many ways now act more to reinforce the privilege that people are born with than to disrupt it. And the race for status among higher education institutions to rank themselves as more and more selective in order to justify large tuitions that they charge has meant that the very thing that we have believed in, which is higher education, education is a path to upward mobility in this country, is no longer as true as it once was. The Century Foundation did a very sobering report a couple of years ago, and it looked at the numbers of young people, percent of young people in the top income quartile who would earn a BA by the time they were 24 years old. In 1970, it was about 40% of young people in the top income quintile. In 2011, it was 83%. And when they looked at the achievement for the bottom quintile, it was about 7 or 8% in 1970, and it's right around that today, pretty much a flat line, despite all the years of innovation and expenditure on scholarships and on other forms of aid. So in many, many ways, our higher education institutions are not at the vanguard of the fight against inequality that one would hope for them to be. Demographic change, and in particular, the impact of immigration, which we spend so much time as a country demonizing, that we are not able to understand the huge transformational impact it has, not just here in this country, but around the world. If you look at the numbers of people who migrate every year, either because they're displaced by war or environmental change, or they're moving in order to try to create something better for their children and their families, it's 1 billion people a year. About 230 million who move across boundaries, across nations, and about just under 800 million who move within countries like China and India. But the nature of that migration creates enormous challenges for the families, because by and large, when families move in that way, the children are separated from the parents. And research shows increasingly they are separated for as long as 7 months to 5 years. And that creates enormous kinds of challenges for young people's development and learning and for the family and cultural relationships. So because all of our societies around the world spend so much time demonizing people who have migrated, otherizing them, they are not, our school systems and our communities are not able to see these children as the assets that they are and their families as the assets that they are. And that, I think, is a huge underlying cause for some of the structural differences that we see today that will only grow stronger as we move forward. Today, around the world, about 30 to 40% of public school-aged children in the Netherlands, in France, in the UK, in Sweden, and here are children of immigrants. So huge challenge and opportunity to do more and to do better. And then the last thing that I would call out is something that none of us could have quite foreseen at the time, which was the impact of our tough laws on, quote, crime. So to turn to then, how do we understand the moment that we're in, and what would be strategies commensurate with the challenge of the need? And I think here it is, again, a sober picture. Sorry for this, because I am a congenital optimist, but I'm hoping that people will have, we will have a lot of conversation about this. I think one thing that we have to do is to really become a lot braver and a lot more transparent about talking about the ways in which education and employment failures are linked to the broader structures of poverty, of racism, of otherizing that still exist too much in this country. And I think we have a very, very challenging combination of incredibly fluid demographics, incredibly fluid demographic change, as I've just described when you look at the immigration patterns here and around the world, but then very entrenched structures of bias and very, very entrenched institutions that are not changing at the same pace. And our responses, by and large, to those shifts have been what Mark Warren, in a very provocative essay about the need for education justice kinds of networks, he calls these strategies that we primarily have been using technical strategies and organizational strategies, not transformational strategies. He says that by and large, if you look back at over all the things that we have focused on technical things like curriculum or tests or standards, and we have focused on organizational changes, even including some of the kinds of new models that are incredibly powerful and incredibly promising. But that those kinds of changes don't bring transformation, and that his argument is what we need is much more transformational change. And in fact, a movement, a social movement, much more comparable to what the civil rights movement was, to what the women's rights movement was in decades past. And so then you have to ask yourself the question, how do we get a movement? And what he argues is you do a couple of things. First, you have to start with something that Sam understood incredibly well, which is collective action and empowering the voice of the people who are most directly affected by the changes, by the structures that are failing them, by the oppressions that are holding them back. And they have to be in the driver's seat in many, many ways. But to make that kind of change requires allies. It requires coalitions. It requires people working together across interests. And it requires redefining what those interests are. Because in the end, you have to work to build a larger societal consensus that would say, this is not the kind of country we want to be, and this is not the way that we think young people or young families should start out in their lives, given that we all depend on how successful they are. We all depend on their ability to thrive. So it is sort of a dual prompt thing of thinking about how to build power, and then how to build the ability to sort of change hearts and minds, which is in part what the breakthrough of the forgotten half began to do. And I think we have to ask ourselves, if we were to have, quote unquote, a movement like that, what should it be advocating for? And here I think we tend to get into each group thinking its solution or its piece of the envelope is the answer, its particular reform strategies, its underfinanced organization that really needs help, even though other organizations have interesting models as well. And what Sam would remind us is that the responses that we should aim for are responses that do not divide and segment. They are the responses that would see young people as whole beings. And again, just reading from his summary from The Forgotten Path, he says, we have to remember young people's experiences at home, in school, in the community, and at work are strongly interconnected. And our response to problems that arise in any of these domains must be equally well integrated. Our society cannot expect to deal successfully with just one aspect of a young person's life and hope to bring focus to every other. Efforts to produce success in school without complementary efforts in families and communities are unlikely to make a substantial difference for young people. In addition, since the years before age 16 powerfully affect the lives of children and adolescents, recommendations that only center on the needs of 16 to 14-year-olds are incomplete. All young people need more constructive contact with adults who can help them guide their talents into useful and satisfying paths, opportunities to participate in community activities that they and adults value, especially giving service to others, special help with particularly difficult problems ranging from learning disabilities to substance addiction, and initial jobs, no matter how modest, that offer a path to accomplishment and to career opportunity. So I think as we spend the next hours together and as we all continue on in this work that we are called to do and that Sam must be watching to see how it's going on, where it's going to get to, we need to remember to challenge ourselves to work for transformational change, not transactional kinds of changes, and to take approaches to young people that see them as old people, and always to remember the most vulnerable young people that Sam cared most about. And I'll leave you with one thought, which is really about where Betsy started, which is about what Sam does so well, which was that he knew that the fundamental currency, in a sense, that makes everything work is the currency of relationships among people that are going to work together and partner for hard change over a long period of time. And that it is our ability to get better at getting better and to stay constant at doing that that is the best hope we have for making progress. And that makes me hopeful, because I think with AYPF and with the people in this room, if we can do that, we have, it's the necessary thing for us to be able to make progress. So I want to leave you, close with a quote from St. Augustine about hope. He says, "Hope has two beautiful daughters. Their names are anger and courage. Anger at the way things are, and courage to see that they do not remain as they are." May it be so with our work. Thank you.
It is not your responsibility to finish the work of perfecting the world, but neither are you free to stop trying. In other words, the enormity of the task must not dissuade us from rolling up our sleeves and doing our part of the work. Efrem, your powerful essay embodies this ethic beautifully. If you were here, my father would take you out to lunch and where he had a coupon. Ask you 100 questions about your life, about your family, about your dreams, and he would become your mentor and your advocate and your champion for life.
Education and public service have always been a big part of my upbringing. I was born and raised in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, a country where the culture took the Christian calling of loving one's neighbor as oneself to the heart, and public service was the very fabric of community bond. When I moved to America at the age of 12, my father, who could not come with us, made sure to emphasize the importance of education and why we should do our best to escape the harsh troubles of life. Of course, like most young people, I didn't understand why people made such a big deal out of education. Yes, learning new stuff every day seemed nice, but the bigger picture was missing in order to connect the smaller dots. After transitioning to the States, I attended McFarland Middle School in Washington, D.C. During my first few years, not being able to speak English and communicate with others was not the hardest part. Instead, the hardest part about moving to a different country for me was the immediate but gradual cultural shift that was becoming more and more apparent. The war between the worlds, the one I had left behind and the new one I had yet to embrace. To be or not to be was the real question, as Shakespeare eloquently asked in Hamlet. Should I be wearing my pants a little lower to seem cool? Should I be wearing some Jordan shoes to school? And should I be a little disrespectful to teachers as to others? It is naturally easier to flow with the current of life than to swim against it. Hence, I tried to be something I was never meant to be. I tried to pull my pants down. No, in fact, I did not have to. I wore my older brother's pants that were much bigger than me, and someone had given a reason for why my pants were sagging. I tried so hard to get a Jordan shoe, and a member from church finally got me my first and last pair, Air Jordan 19. All eyes seemed stuck on my shoe for those few short-lived weeks, but the rush felt good while it lasted. However, similar to the tiger mother of Asia, I had a lion mother of Africa. Soon enough, I started to realize a college education was not only a dream, but also a reality I could strive for with the help of the various great mentors I had. Mentors who, similar to my high school teachers, were more than willing to revise my college statement essays with all the grammatical errors of broken English, and who masters really built bonds I still cherish to this day, even though some of them are across the country or have unfortunately passed away recently. During my last year of college, I wrote a research paper on the dropout rate and Muslim incarceration rates in America, which is particularly acute among minority subgroups. Therefore, soon after graduating from St. Mary's College in Maryland, I decided to volunteer at the very first school I attended when I first came to this country. Nevertheless, when I found that it was closed, I continued volunteering at Roosevelt High School, where I attended my freshman year of high school. After assisting some AmeriCorps members at the site, I felt a sense of inadequacy and frustration the students were feeling when suddenly being told to prepare for the SATs and apply for colleges, both of which they either did not know about until that point or did not develop the necessary mathematical reading skills to comprehend some of the questions and write statement essays, let alone under time pressure. I knew exactly how they felt because I had a similar experience during my junior and senior year of high school, and it was not pleasant. As a result, I have gradually worked my way down the age group of students I work with. I'm currently volunteering as an AmeriCorps member with middle school students via the Maryland Multicultural Youth Center, a branch of the LAYC in Maryland at Buckeye Middle School. I work with mostly English as second language ESL students in a seventh grade math class who often seem to care more about unscratching their Jordan shoes than understanding the importance of learning math. And it is not always because they are just being lazy or careless, but because they simply do not understand how to navigate the complexities of life within the environment they find themselves in, which can be difficult even for adults and immigrant parents, let alone at such a volatile age when everything is being discovered or amplified and affecting them in unfavorable ways. How do you help students overcome the fear and insecurity they have about a particular subject when they are being tested again before they had enough time to confidently demonstrate what they have learned instead of going through another dreadful experience? What do you say to a girl who just came from South America and is a great student, but is gradually being influenced to find more value in her beauty than in her work ethics and personal integrity? What do you tell a boy who shouts inappropriate things in class because a math teacher wrote XXX on the board? How do you tell some students to be mindful of the lyrics they listen to when they memorize whole chunks of rap music and disruptively sing in class without lumping an entire genre of music and dubbing it bad? These and many other questions abound, but lectures by the teachers and myself only go so far before the students start turning out. As my favorite African proverb states, it takes a village to raise a child, and indeed it does. All the social phenomena happening outside of the school walls inevitably filter into the school environment, and the teacher or mentor is only one aspect of the equation in the process of guiding a person's child. Although I'm the least of all to judge them, I certainly did not think life would take me around in a full circle in order for me to realize this vicious cycle is cultural and a current that continues to sweep millions of naive kids away. While they are developmentally immature, they are being exposed to content beyond their age and their capacity to cope with it in the absence of an interconnected community. As a result, students are harboring a state of mind with far-reaching consequences of not only eroding the value of family and community, but also of life itself. The various disciplinary actions taken at the school seem to address only the tip of the iceberg. We need a community reformed by love, love that transcends racial and socioeconomic boundaries to change the hearts of policymakers, mentors, educators, and the leaders of tomorrow. Simply because we live in a world where the at-risk youth of today are becoming a threat to the livelihood of our own very kids and grandkids rather than being their friends or coworkers discovering something great.